Hey guys, welcome back. In this particular video, we will be covering about the reactive programming with the perspective of MuleSoft, Mule4. So just to give a brief background of it, the basic idea behind every integration technology is to build integration solutions that must cater to high volumes of data, right? So within this latest Mule runtime, that is Mule4, it uses the reactive programming to increase the scalability so that all the integrators or the integration developers can deliver a smooth and very high productivity based solutions for their end users. Okay, so in order to understand in a better way, consider a Mule flow, which is like a chain of non-blocking publisher and subscriber pairs. The source is the publisher to the flow and also subscriber to the flow, as it must receive the event published by the last event processor on the flow. Basically, just take an example of HTTP listener. Let's suppose it publishes an event to the first event processor on the flow and subscribes to the event which is being produced by the very last event processor within the same flow. So in this scenario, each event processor subscribes and processes in a non-blocking way. Okay, now giving this introduction in just to set up the things, let's discuss more about this back pressure. We have discussed about this publisher and how the same HTTP listener can publish an event to the first event processor on the flow and subscribe to the event produced by the last event processor on the flow itself. So it is having the producer is publishing a particular push event and the consumer is there and it is again subscribing back to it. So there is a closed loop of it, right? But there are chances of back pressure. So in order to understand what the back pressure is, so by looking back pressure in mind and like looking on to these particular figures, one immediate concept of Bernoulli's theorem come to my mind. Okay, so just to give you a better idea, there is a natural phenomenon like back pressure which occurs in confined spaces like pipes, water pipes, right? So it opposes the desired flow of gases or any liquid through that particular hole or that particular opening. So engineers have to design the likes of exhaust pipe with this in mind so that gas can move through the confined space with least amount of impedance. This forms the basis of the reactive programming model. So in order to allow the subscriber to consume the event stream without being overwhelmed by too many events, the subscriber must be able to apply the back pressure, or in other words, it should signal the producer to slow down for the time being because it is not able to process the incoming influx of payloads. So there is a two different sort of back pressure in Mule4 which we used to discuss. The first one is automatic, the second one is manual. So Mule4 applications are being automatically configured so that event source receives a back pressure signal whenever all threads are completely blocked or currently being executed with no free threads available on the pool. So in practical terms, this will trigger the HTTP listener, for example, to respond back with 503 server busy, or the JMS listener will not acknowledge the receipt of the of a particular message, which means the Mule flow is not ready to take up any new influx of request. So out of memory errors are avoided as a result of this configuration because it is being stopped at the first level of the flow itself. That is HTTP listener, it's at the level of HTTP listener when it is going to trigger the flow. There itself it will stop, or JMS listener level only it will stop and say like 503 server busy, or in case of JMS listener, it will say it will not acknowledge the receipt of the message. So in this way, one of the possible cases of out of memory or heap issues can be avoided. Now, having said that, what about this manual back pressure? Developer can also configure each event processor to signal back pressure to the event source through the maximum concurrency attribute. So this particular value of maximum concurrency, it can affect the number of events that can pass through the event per second. So there are many things, connectors which gives this option of max concurrency. So let me see if I can bring up something. Oh, 1 second, guys. So let me bring up something. Let me open this data view just to give you a very small example where I'm saying about this is. Let me put up something like, let's say, consume. Okay, I'm just trying to show you that max concurrency option somewhere. Give me a moment, let me try to locate that thing. Let me pull up this file adapter, file palette. So I put something, I just want to show you that max concurrency somewhere, it will be there only. Is it on the main flow level? Yes, here it goes. So at the main max concurrency, we will set it up this particular feature. So we can put any number. So if you click over here and you will come to know max concurrency, that's value determines the maximum level of parallelism that the flow can use to optimize for performance when processing the messages. So similarly, we can configure this max concurrency particular tag onto the specific connectors as well. Okay, let me go back to the PowerPoint presentation. So so there are two different ways we have discussed, right? Back pressure indicates the source system to slow down for the time being so that the flows are ready to handle more incoming requests, because otherwise it will, and in order to avoid any out of memory errors, it will say 503 server errors or server busy error, or GMS listener will not respond back to the acknowledge the particular message. For manual back pressure, there are the configuration available on the flow level as well as on the component level, which we can configure. Okay, now what about this non-blocking operations in MuleFlow? So non-blocking operations are like, these are very normal in or being preventively used in MuleFlow and are fundamental to the reactive programming approach. The idea here is that the threads which sits around waiting for an operation to complete, those are wasted resources, right? So any thread which is just in the idle state, it is as good as in the waste state. On the flip side of it, thread switching can be disadvantages. So it means like frequent switching of threads is also create a lot of IO operation and thus can degrade the overall performance of the system. So it is not ideal that each event processor in a Mule application flow execute on different thread, as this will increase the latency of the flow execution. There will be some delay as well in some of the event processing. However, the advantage is that MuleFlow can propose a higher level of concurrency because we keep threads busy with the necessary tasks. So just to give you an example, let's suppose there is a database module read operation. For example, it blocks and waits for responses to come back from the database server. That's bit, it is like going to a for a time being, the thread will wait till it gets back the response. So during the meantime, there will be lot many other operations which are waiting for this thread to get free, and it will have to wait for that particular time being. So this is this could be an example of blocking operation. that is read database module read operation, or if you consider the non-blocking HTTP requester, it just sends off the request on one thread, but that same thread is immediately freed up and doesn't wait for the response from the server. The net effect is greater concurrency and throughput, and we can have more payload or more incoming traffic on that particular channel or on that HTTP listener or whatever the triggering flow is there. So this, with this, we come to the end of a brief introduction about reactive programming in MuleFor. I hope this you like this particular video, and it gives you a very brief introduction about it, and it will set up the tone for the next upcoming set of videos, which will be about thread management and the other stuff. So thanks for watching, and have a great day.